Hi, thank you for joining me this evening on Greater Reading Public Eye. I'm Robin Costenbader-Jacobson. I'm the principal of RCJ Consulting Associates, and thank you so much for joining me this evening. I have a great guest with me, a longtime friend of mine, and I'm really happy to share her with you, home viewers. Before I get started, I just want to remind you that Greater Reading Public Eye is a one-on-one personal interview with one guest, and we like to talk to people who make a difference in our Greater Reading community, and certainly my guest has and continues to do that. I'd like to introduce you to Karen Kramer. Karen, thanks for being here.
Thank you, Robin, for having me. I always love talking with you, so this is easy.
Well, you're a dear. Let me tell our home viewers that Karen, we want to talk about weaving your dream, because Karen certainly has done that. And she is a certified life coach, and she's also the director of employee engagement at Remcom Plastics. And that's a recent new position for you.
Yes, it
at
is.
Remcom. So before we get into your position and what you're currently doing in the community and in the workplace in downtown Reading, let's talk a little bit about you being a native of the area, correct?
Yes, I am. Born and raised here in Reading. I lived in West Reading until I was in third grade, and then moved to the Wilson area, graduated from Wilson High School, and from there went to college, Shippensburg, and I met my husband, who just happens to be a Reading native, but we didn't know each other. We met each other at school.
Oh, at Shippensburg. Oh, I never knew that. I didn't know that's where he went also. Okay. You have some other friends in the community that you went to school with, right? Crystal?
No, I met Crystal at Med-Ed.
My first job at Med-Ed.
No, okay. She went to Kutztown.
Okay. Yeah. See, and I didn't know that about Crystal. I'm thinking all these years she went to school where you did.
No, we met each other at Med-Ed, which was a lucky day for me, too.
So you, a great lady. We're talking about Crystal Seitz from the Greater Reading Visitors Bureau. But you came back from Shippensburg, and you settled here in Reading.
Settled here in Reading, married, two kids, grown. One's a school teacher, and the other one is a junior at Bloomsburg.
And what did you major in?
I majored in communications.
Okay.
In fact, that is what my degree is in. And I minored in psychology, which is interesting because that's just what kind of weaved in and out of my life and all my professional jobs. And I kept kind of coming back to that. So the end result was getting into coaching and getting certified
where you are
there.
Now. Yep. It's interesting. I know that you had a position, and I was just thinking of this location today. In fact, I spoke of this location today, but you were involved back in the day when the outlets were on 8th Street. Wasn't that one of your first positions?
That is correct. That was my very first job.
Because I missed that.
Professional, out of college, and I'll tell you, even today, that's where I learned just about everything that I could possibly have learned in that 3.5 years.
Wow.
I worked at the Reading Outlet Center at 9th and Oley, and that was quite an experience, a good one.
Yeah, I miss that. It used to be nice to drive through there, even if it was crazy with cars and just that activity and that hustle bustle. So I was thinking of the neighborhood, somebody that used to live there, and we were talking about it. So I thought of you today where that was concerned. But those are days gone by.
Yes, they are.
So and I remember talking to you years ago, you were always interested, as you said, in things that related to behavioral science, psychology, and you wanted to always be involved in somehow in HR, in human resources. And how did it start to, because you did a good bit of your career with one business.
Yes. And then I left, and then I kind of came back.
Yeah.
But in all the positions that I held, they were all communications related, which really ends up being people related. Whether you were working with outside customers or inside customers, but particularly in the sales end of it. I worked with Reese for many, many years and as an account executive, and that's really sales and service. And, you know, I learned how to listen and ask questions, because that's when you really found out what the need was.
Right, what people
that you could
want.
Maybe answer mm-hmm. that. And that holds true for anything, coworkers, bosses. Just listen. Just mm-hmm. listen. Mm-hmm. And so from the psychology side of things, that just always intrigued me, how people work, because no matter what job there is, there are people behind it that work
right,
it.
Right.
And they really are the engines and the trains. So after 28 years in communications, and I'll tell you how this got started, with the internet and publisher, and people were starting able to do a lot of their own design, because that was a big thing at Reese. And one part that I loved working with clients is I got in from the ground up. So we worked strategically.
Mm-hmm.
We designed, we created, we executed strategically, but together.
Right.
So the agency always knew what was going on. And then as you know, as I was saying, you know, the internet and all the tools and options that are out there now, I just
started to take over.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I ended up still being servicing the client, but it was I felt that it was more kind of order taking. I wasn't involved anymore, and I really missed that, being from the ground
wow.
up. And
you like that planning and creating
process.
Well,
because there's collaboration
and
there's brainstorming
mm-hmm.
and you figure out together, right? Mm-hmm. And so different thoughts and processes were weaved together. So we always knew, we were always on the same page,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
rather than just kind of coming in at the end and just trying to think that you're fulfilling a particular need
right.
without really knowing the background. Because a lot of times that's where the message comes from, really knowing the background. And so I consider going back to school to get my psychology degree. I minored in psych. So I only had about maybe a year. But then I thought, oh, and then I have to get my master's.
Mm-hmm.
Then I have to start a business.
Mm-hmm.
And as much as I loved school, I loved the social part of it, the academics. I mean, I really enjoyed it when I was in my major. And I thought, oh, I don't know what to do. Well, then, actually, my husband found on the internet, on the MSNB website, coaching. And he was intrigued, read it, sent it to me, and that just really got
that
the ball
hit for you.
Rolling
mm-hmm.
because it's still helping people move forward with action plans, supporting, encouraging, and you see the light bulbs go off. I mean, it just makes your day.
Well, and you, in moving into this process, you did what I'm hearing and listening to, and I did myself, where you really want to do and become something different than what you're currently doing, but taking your skill sets and your passion and what you enjoy
mm-hmm.
with you and going mm-hmm. to that next step or that next level, and
mm-hmm.
you actually did it. You broke away from a long-term career
mm-hmm.
and security,
mm-hmm.
and you went for it.
Mm-hmm.
So
I can almost use myself as a good example.
Yes, yeah.
Of getting out of that, you know, that little circle.
Mm-hmm.
And we all think that we just have to jump over it to make it bigger, and we don't. We just can just even just put half a step over it, but guess what? That circle just got bigger. And when you're working with someone like a coach who is objective, encouraging, supportive, and above all, holding you accountable. Because a lot of times we can do these things ourselves. We manage ourselves well.
Mm-hmm.
But humans...
We don't always think we manage ourselves
that's right.
well.
As humans, it's so easy to give ourselves excuses.
Mm-hmm.
And we're really good at that.
Mm-hmm.
And justification for not doing something. Oh, I'll do it tomorrow because tomorrow's another day. And when you're working with a coach, you already are making a commitment to try and do to move forward.
Right.
So
right.
that in itself, you know, that needs to be planned too, to make sure that that's something that you want to do and you're ready to work at. Just not quite sure where to start.
Well, with our home viewers, and again, this is Greater Reading Public Eye on BCTV. I'm Robin Costenbader-Jacobson, and I have as a guest this evening Karen Kramer. And Karen's talking to us about life coaching, which she took on as an occupation not that many years ago. Would you say 5 years ago or so?
Oh, seven.
Is it that long?
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. Yes. I can't believe
that. It was 07
that.
When I received my certification. And then, I guess it was toward, the beginning of the following year that I started to try and get all about possibilities off the ground.
Well, let's pick back up on there. We're going to break for BCTV.
Okay.
Home viewers, stay tuned, and we'll be right back with you.
You're watching Greater Reading Public Eye on BCTV.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other stories and information, go to bctv.org.
Thank you. I hope you stayed tuned, or if you're just staying tuned, this is Greater Reading Public Eye on BCTV. I'm Robin Costenbader-Jacobson with RCJ Consulting Associates, and my guest this evening on Greater Reading Public Eye is Karen Kramer. We are talking about her, her life, her family, and her coaching occupation, which has led her to yet another position in downtown Reading with a manufacturer, and we'll talk a little bit more with her about that. So we're talking about life coaching, and you really got it going 7 years ago already, and your business was?
All about possibilities.
Mm-hmm. Who do you recommend for people watching at home? Who do you recommend coaching for when you say you've got to be held accountable, you have somebody to bounce things off objectively?
You know, it's interesting because, when you hear the word life coaching, it's like, well, what is that? It's anything and everything to do with any part of your life. So, for instance, if you do want to compare it with like a sports coach, what a sports coach, let's just say a coach of a little league, what he or she does is helps the kids practice, shows them maybe where they're stuck, works on certain areas, might send them home with an action plan. For instance, try batting for every day until our next practice, or catching, or football, whatever it is. When they come back, if it's there's encouragement and there's support. So life coaching very much is the same kind of thing, but with areas where you're stuck. When I say stuck, I'm talking about a healthy mind. This is where you are, and this is where you want to be. We're not psychologists. Psychologists typically deal with things in the past where you're kind of maybe stuck in a pattern. Mm-hmm. You got to break through that, but when you're ready to move forward, that's when you see a coach. So, for instance, I'm going to give you an example. I had a coaching client from the Midwest, a surgeon. He's a doctor, so we're not like, and from what I understand, a very successful heart surgeon, and he was stuck in trying to build a relationship with his 22-year-old son.
He said, and we
coach over the phone. He does not need to be in person, although I personally like it in person, seeing in person eye to eye. And we worked for several months in just ways where he can maybe not have so much control. His son is 22. He has his own life.
Right.
And sometimes it's just kind of working through certain areas, a lot of questioning, a lot of what would you do, how would you feel if someone did this to you, when you're like, well, I never thought about it like that. And when we finished our coaching, they were off to a nice start. Who knows where that went?
Yeah,
we coached for 3 months. It can be careers. You're stuck, like I was. I was stuck. I knew that I wanted more. I didn't know what it was. And I wish I had known about coaching. I should have hired a coach then. But I really didn't know about it, and I should have. When I look back, I followed the steps and was brave. It's courageous to move forward on something when you have no clue what the end result might be. And in the end, I have coaches. That's what keeps moving you forward.
Right, the people you're surrounded with.
It's what keeps moving forward. And what's interesting is, and I might have told you this, Robin, I'll tell you again. I was at a baby shower several years ago and sat next to a young lady who just happened to be visiting her mother. She lives in California. And she knew the girl too, so she came along to the baby shower. And she said, what do you do? And I said, I'm a life coach. And she goes, oh, I have a coach. And I said, you do? Mm-hmm. She was 25. And she goes, why do you ask like that? I said, because I'm just really kind of breaking into the business, and a lot of people around here anyway, mm-hmm. you know, this is something new. Mm-hmm. And she goes, oh my gosh, everyone in California yeah. has a coach. We wouldn't be without one, because it's what's getting us ahead
right.
that much faster.
Wow.
I thought, wow.
No, you never shared that
didn't
with
I?
Me.
Okay, I'm always telling someone
wow,
that's right. I didn't know if that was you. Yeah. So it's really for healthy people that are just a little stuck. The mm-hmm. wheels just mm-hmm. keep turning, and you just need someone objective and know that it's confidential, and that just helps you move forward. Just little baby steps.
Wow. So you're coaching, and I guess you could still do that on the side, but it led you. And before we get off coaching, you have an event coming up where you'll be speaking, I believe, at the Women
to
Women.
The Women to Women. Actually, yes. it's an hour breakout session.
Mm-hmm.
And Tracy Beakey and I are going to be kind of co-coaching or facilitating that group.
And that's on Friday?
That is Friday the 19th.
April 19th.
April 19th mm-hmm. over at...
The Crown.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, I
wanted to say Sharon.
It.
I thought, no. No, that's
so,
not right.
And I think people can still make reservations. We're also honoring the new Athena, Paula Barrett,
yep.
from Reinzelkunstlesher.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
you will be doing an hour session
we
there.
Yep.
If anybody's interested, they can contact womentowomen.com or call the Chamber of Commerce. So you moved on through your coaching. You got involved in something somewhat related.
Yes, and it started with, you know, just talk about relationships. I mean, in one way or another, we are always connected. So don't think for a second someone you worked with mm-hmm. like 10 years ago and... One thing just sort of leads to the other, and because of Mr. Orlando, who was at Karen Treatment Centers at the time,
working.
She was yes working. She started a new program that she was managing, and it just got big. It just
oh.
got too big for her to manage it alone because
okay.
she had a great deal of responsibility. And she said, "Would you be willing to do this?" And I'm like, "Gosh, yes!"
Mm-hmm.
And it was. Managing a leader-led behavioral type program, but it broke out into working with different departments, coaching one-on-one, coaching departments, getting them to work together, communicate better, and it was wonderful.
Great, yeah.
It was wonderful. I loved it.
It's so interesting.
It was just...
And this was for the people that worked at Karen
yes,
Foundation.
Yes, mm-hmm. I had nothing to do with patients. I'm not mm-hmm. qualified to work with patients. This was just the employees, but it was about 650, because there were three facilities, well, four now. And it was a wonderful experience. And
you were really enjoying it.
I was. I loved it.
And then something else happened.
Yes, it was just a great organization. And then, you know, do you call it divine intervention mm-hmm. or what? But a friend of mine said to me, I want you to meet Pete Connors, who is the owner and president of RemCon, because he just read a book called The Dream Manager. And he's intrigued by this, and she read it, and said, you know what, Karen, I think, would you be willing to talk to Pete and just provide a little insight, because he wants to get involved with this. He wants to give back what he can to his employees. And that's what the Dream Manager is all about. And so Pete and I met, and we just kind of clicked. And then I met his COO, who mm-hmm. we've kind of, from day-to-day operations, runs the company, Rich McGuire, great guy. And he and I connected. And it was like, you know what, why don't you just come here and do this?
So what's an example of what you do? And I know that you've been there about, a quarter of a year?
3 months.
Right.
Yep,
so,
you're exactly right.
What kind of thing do you do with employees at a work site?
Well, everything is contained.
Yeah,
everything is contained right there.
Mm-hmm.
And what the Dream Manager, and if you have a chance, it's a short read.
Matthew
It's a good
Kelly.
Book by Matthew Kelly. Mm-hmm. And the book is somewhat fictional, but it's completely based on true facts. It's about a janitorial company and where turnover was just atrocious. And one thing led to the other. And what was discovered, and then this is what the book is written about, that is when you engage employees in their lives, not just on the job.
Right.
I mean, employee disengagement is
you spend a lot of time on the job.
I mean, for an eight-hour, $8 an hour employee, mm-hmm. if they quit, I mean, they could be there 3 weeks.
Right.
And if they quit, that's costing you an average of $3,500 till you find someone again, bring them in, train mm-hmm. them, and then. So what this book is all about is literally working with the employees, asking them, what are your dreams? Mm-hmm. And in this case, a lot of times dreams are just, you know, I'd like to go to Hawaii for a week.
Right.
Or I would like to have a college education. Or I would like to give my kids a great Christmas, just 1 year.
So when you get that information from employees, mm-hmm. what do you do with it then? Is it just their opportunity to express themselves?
No. Then we go right into coaching mode.
Ah, okay.
We go right into coaching mode. So I'm hoping to do some group coaching too, because mm-hmm. some people don't want to really fully express what they're feeling, but they're getting a lot out of listening to others. Mm-hmm. I love group coaching, and I know you do that. Mm-hmm. You do that too with your facilitation, because you get the best of the best
sure,
coming out of that.
Sure.
But what happens is, if an employee has a dream, set an appointment with me, just my office, mm-hmm. and we start talking about it. This is my one goal. This is what I want to do. All right, let's take a look at where you are. What have you tried? What's worked? What hasn't?
So you encourage them to achieve it, and
then we walk away with, okay, what are you committing to do? Wow. What will you commit to? Mm-hmm. What can you do? Well, I think I can do one and two. Mm-hmm. Okay. Come back in a month. We meet once a month. And let's see where you are.
Wow. And sometimes what an opportunity at the workplace.
It is. It's wonderful.
Where a lot of workers feel that nobody wants to hear them or listen to them and mm-hmm. does not care about them mm-hmm. as a person. Mm-hmm. I had somebody say mm-hmm. that to me 2 days ago mm-hmm. on a job site. Mm-hmm. Thank you for asking about my history and what I'd like to do mm-hmm. on this job, because nobody's ever asked me mm-hmm. since I started here. Mm-hmm. So,
and then you make such a valid point. Mm-hmm. And look how much time that took. Two seconds?
Yeah.
You know,
and I was so surprised by the response.
And if you think about it, it makes you feel good that mm-hmm. there's a little bit of an interest. And the whole point, or the whole focus ends up happening. What happens is that when employees are engaged in their personal lives, what happens? They're excited.
Right.
They're motivated. There's hope. Mm-hmm. And that immediately spills over into the workplace.
Just to know somebody cares or asks
yes.
does just that, as we said, yes. makes such a difference.
And I think that's one of the things Pete says to me. Pete Connor says to me, "So what, me?" And I said, "You know what? You just what you want to do." Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I mean, that speaks volumes to me from the heart.
Well, as you always speak, is from the heart and to other people's hearts. You are really incredible to work with.
I think
you've made a change for a lot of people. And we could go on, and I could interview you for another hour, but our time is coming to an end, unfortunately, because I'd love to talk about... That's what I tell people, but I'd love to talk. You've done a lot in the community and volunteering, and you have a number of passions, mm-hmm. but unfortunately, we're going to have to say goodbye in a few seconds. If there were one bit or item of advice that you'd give to our home viewers, mm-hmm. What would it be?
Stop and listen.
Oh.
Just listen.
Wow.
You know, just good morning. Mm-hmm. A smile and a good morning can set the day for someone. Sets a positive tone for someone. You may never even know it, but boy, they sure do.
Wow.
And just be aware of your presence when you're around someone. Give them your full attention. Even if it's just for a minute.
Stop and listen is Karen Kramer's mm-hmm. advice for all of us. I hope you can put that into good practice through the next month until we meet again on Greater Reading Public Eye. Karen Kramer, thank you for being here. Love spending time with you.
Thank
and
you.
I'm sure our home
thank
viewers
you.
Did as well, no doubt. Good night.